Music occupies more areas of our brain than language does. Humans are a musical species. Music can move us to the heights and depths of emotion. It's often what we turn to in moments of joy or of despair. Dr. Oliver Sacks has made the study of the human brain his life's work. His most recent book explores the lives of people dealing with extraordinary medical conditions and how music works in their minds in strange and surprising ways. These remarkable case studies are testimony to the power of music, a power that science can't yet fully explain.
Although I go out and see patients, and seeing patients is my life, my other life is coming here and typing, which I tend to do very rapidly with two fingers. I never learned to use all my fingers, and I think I've written all my books on this typewriter. And there are a few problems here. I don't have an exclamation mark, but I can put in those by hand.
Dr. Oliver Sacks is a neurologist and the author of many acclaimed books, including The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat. His books are filled with the compelling stories of his patients, ordinary people coping with extraordinary neurological conditions. His book, Awakenings, based on the work he did with catatonic patients back in the 60s, was made into a film starring Robert De Niro and Robin Williams, playing the part of Sacks. His most recent work, Musicophilia, concentrates on his lifelong fascination with the connection between music and the human brain. He says, "For virtually all of us, music has great power. This propensity to music shows itself in infancy and probably goes back to the very beginnings of our species."
What came first, in music or language?
Well, this has been argued for 2.5 centuries and probably continue to be argued. Darwin, who wrote quite a lot about music, felt very strongly that music came first and that song and dance were selected sexually for courtship and that language followed.
I could imagine that music came before language in a funny kind of way. At what point does the fetus, do you think, develop a sort of sensibility to music?
This is really anecdotal. Certainly some of my musical friends who played Beethoven when the fetus was in utero then insist that the child is fond of Beethoven or fond of rock music. I mean, certainly sound will get transmitted to the fetus.
And the mother with a child, with a newborn child, tends to kind of coo and make sounds and noises, almost musical noises, with a baby. Of course, physical rocking.
So we treat our babies musically as if they were little musical beings before they are verbal beings.
Oliver Sacks is 75 now, but he's still working as a professor of clinical neurology. He's always been interested in using the art of observation to document human feelings and experiences. But Sacks is not just a scientist, he's also an anthropologist. And his new collection of case histories tells the stories of people who have almost magically unlocked a part of their musical mind. One of the most fascinating cases that Sacks has studied is of a young man called Matt Giordano, who lives here in the quiet suburbs of upstate New York. But Matt's house is anything but quiet. In fact, he's had to seal up his windows to try to keep the noise down in his neighborhood.
So, show me around, Matt.
Matt has severe Tourette's syndrome. He's found that only one thing can help him control the involuntary movements or tics that Tourette's gives him: drumming.
Want to play?
Yeah.
Okay.
That was amazing. So how do you feel now?
Feel better. Feel, taste kind of washed them out a little bit there. I have some drums down here too. Basement's a little bit of a mess, I apologize. It's a basement.
Can you play those for us at all?
Yeah, I have to set it up real quick.
Yeah, set it up a bit.
Matt's now 25, but the discovery that he had a natural ability for the drums came one day when he was 2 years old and heard the Moody Blues song, Singer in a Rock and Roll Band.
That Moody Blues tune, that was the thing that really got you going, basically.
Yeah, well, I was two years old. And my parents, you know, just bought me a little toy drum just to keep, you know, a two-year-old occupied sometimes. And so they were listening to the Moody Blues on the record player. Huge Moody Blues fan, Moody Blues fans. And so they were in the other room, and that song, I'm just a singer in a rock old band, came on. And all of a sudden they noticed I'm playing right along with the drums at 2 years old. So they kind of recognized I had a natural ability and gift at playing the drums.
Do you know how to play that? And the back into that?
I think I might remember maybe a little bit. I'll give it a whirl. I tell you, you know, you guys, you British people know how to play your music.
The discovery of Matt's gift for drumming coincided with the first signs of his symptoms. This was back in the 1980s, when little was known about Tourette's, and no one really knew what was wrong with Matt, not least his parents, Kathy and Tony.
So, did it take you long to did you discover very early on that Matt had Tourette's?
We started noticing symptoms around when he was about 2 years old, but, you know, we didn't have a clue. We didn't have any idea why he was doing what he was doing. And it really wasn't until the tics got very severe. He would come home from school and spin in a circle on the floor for like 2 hours at a time, and he'd be crying, "Mommy, Mommy, help me, help me." But if I tried to stop him, he would get angry at me because he needed to, you know, complete the tic. So that was when we brought him to the doctors and got him diagnosed.
What were the symptoms besides, obviously, the ticking and the lack of coordination? There was also the anger, wasn't there?
Anything could set him into a rage, and it was very destructive. He broke windows and kicked holes in walls and broke our windshield in the car, and it was dangerous. It was dangerous for him. It was dangerous for our family members. But he's always been the sweet kid that he is now. You know, when he wasn't in a rage, just the gentlest, kindest, most wonderful person.
I mean, there was a period when he had to be sort of taken away from home, wasn't it? When he was sectioned, essentially, between the ages of about 8 and 12. I mean, was it that bad?
Yeah, it was that bad. He was either going to kill himself. I walked into the kitchen one day and he had a knife pointed at his chest because he knew that he was violent against Tony, was violent against me, violent against his brother and sister. And like I said, he's a sweet, wonderful, gentle person. And to have that other part of him that he knew he was upsetting the family that much was destroying him.
Matt was in hospital for 4 years. And it was during this time that he found that his talent for drumming could help him control his Tourette's.
At school, he stopped being the weird kid with these tics, and he started becoming the drummer. Well, it was very good for his self-esteem.
Music demands focus.
The Tourette's doesn't so much go away as I think its energies get focused and channeled, right, and can even form a source of strength or energy. But it is the organization, the order of music, which is their great sort of bastion against chaos.
I mean, people are trying to work out whether music, neurologically, whether that affects the brain and, you know, in a way, the emotions as well.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, I don't know if there's proof or not, but I mean, how much proof do you need to realize this is pudding? You know, this proof is in the pudding. I was playing this rhythm in a very balanced form of my body, a very balanced form of tempo and everything else. Like, it was almost like my brain was a puzzle, all right? And some of the pieces were not in place. And all of a sudden, everything just kind of clicked in the two hemispheres of my brain. And I literally felt it like this. I was doing it, and all of a sudden it went about this fast, and it kind of just clicked into place, and it literally went down my entire body about that fast. And it was a very very symmetrical balance of my entire being. When that happened, it was amazing.
Can you imagine your life without music?
I would go bonkers. I probably wouldn't be here, literally. All right, my hands are freezing.
Whilst fascinating case studies have defined Sack's work, there is another thread running through his latest book, Sack's Own Life. He was born in London in 1933, the fourth and youngest child of two doctors, themselves the children of Jewish immigrants.
Going back to your childhood, your parents were both medical practitioners, and they were very, very musical, is that right?
My father was very musical. He would always have sort of tiny... I see there's one here. He would always have these little miniature scores in his pockets, and between patients he would take them out and look at them, and he'd maintain that he could hear an entire orchestra or choir in detail, that he didn't need a record player.
You mean he could just hear it in his head?
He could hear it in his head, and particular instruments could be emphasized, and he could mentally conduct it. I was in awe of this. My mother was the opposite. She could hardly hold a tune in her head, although she was fond of music. She loved Schubert. She loved singing. I feel tearful when I think of some of the songs she sang in a slightly off-key, slightly Cockney way, but with great feeling. The house was full of music, and it was also full of science and medicine. And so, in a way, they formed natural partners.
Sacks graduated from Oxford University and moved to New York in the 1960s, where he went to work at Beth Abraham Hospital in the Bronx. Events that took place here inspired his book Awakenings and had a profound effect on Sacks. This was the first place he witnessed the therapeutic power of music. When he arrived here, the corridors were lined with patients suffering from sleepy sickness, a disease which affected over 1 million people around the world in the 1920s. Sacks was now working with a ward full of survivors and famously gave them the drug L-DOPA, which brought them out of their catatonic states for a brief time. But he also discovered that even without the drug, there was one thing that could stir them.
These people, unable to take a step by themselves or utter a syllable, could dance, could sing, and could come completely alive for a while with music. That, for me, was the first, you know, it stunned me. It still stuns me to see it. It was an absolute revelation. They were liberated by music. They were freed by music.
Today, Beth Abraham is home to the Institute for Music and Neurologic Function and is a world leader in clinical music therapy. They work with the idea that when the brain processes the different elements of music, it can help awaken other areas of the brain that have been damaged. The Institute's motto is "Music has power," a bold statement that attracted the usually reclusive musician Moby to become a patron.
It seemed borderline absurd and miraculous. Like, I couldn't believe it, you know, that, like, people who can't speak are able to sing, and people who can't walk are able to dance. Like, I mean, it seemed, I was like, is there some sort of messiah involved in this? What they're doing at the Institute, the way they're almost rewiring the brain. You know, like, if you have a damaged part of the brain through music therapy, but you're able to almost sort of, like, reroute around the damaged part. The way the brain can sort of very adaptively rewire itself, it really is miraculous.
I've come to Redhill in Surrey to meet Derek Paravicini. Derek's story is remarkable. He's 28 years old. He's been blind since birth and is severely autistic. In many ways, Derek functions like a four-year-old, and yet he is an astonishingly, almost bafflingly brilliant pianist.
Alan, I'm Derek. Hello, Alan. Thank you.
It's nice to be here, Derek. Is that specially for me?
Yes.
Derek is a musical savant, and a great deal of his brain power is dedicated to hearing, processing, and creating music.
Very nice, too, thank you. What a nice welcome.
Yes, welcome to Redhill, Alan.
Very nice to be here on a beautiful day. And so we've come to see you, did tell you we've come to listen to you playing. We've even brought a little piece of music with us.
Yes.
Because we're making a film about music and how some people have got it and some people haven't got it. And you've got it, Derek.
Yes.
Here it comes. Here it comes.
I've brought some music to play to Derek because his mentor and music teacher, Professor Adam Ockleford, has told me Derek will be able to play it back to me after hearing it only once, no matter how complex it is.
Do you want to try it without the CD?
Try it without the CD, right. Please, Adam.
Yes.
Ready from the beginning?
Here we go.
Derek's turn.
Not only does Derek play the piece back note for note, but I'm amazed by his ability to improvise and play around with the melody.
Good. What would George do with it? Chords.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
My God. So what do you make of that, Adam? You've seen
it. Pretty good. Yeah, you got it, didn't you, Derek? What sort of style was that in, do you think?
George Shearing.
Yeah.
George Shearing.
Sort of bebop-y kind of style.
Kind of bebop kind of style, yes. Yeah.
Derek was born 3.5 months premature and weighed only 1 pound 5 ounces. The oxygen treatment he was given in hospital to keep him alive left him completely blind and with chronic learning difficulties. Even today, he has trouble counting to 10. But when Derek's parents discovered him playing the piano at the age of 2, they knew there was more going on inside his head than the doctors had ever imagined.
Suddenly they realised, of course, that inside that brain where they thought not a lot was going on, actually Derek was mapping out his musical world completely perfectly. It was just extraordinary. When he was about 4, 4.5, his parents brought him to a school for the blind where I was teaching. And I was just teaching a girl called Kelly, and we were working away. And suddenly I was aware that being shoved in the back, and a tiny little Derek had run across and pushed me out of the way and just started to play. Just so motivated to make music even at that stage. Of course, he had the most tiny hands. He could only reach 5 notes, a fifth. And somehow he taught himself, don't cry for me, Argentina, he was playing. But not just the tune, being Derek, he was playing scales and arpeggios, using his elbows and everything to get the notes in.
Do you remember that?
I do remember Derek? That, yes.
Ooh, you were very little.
Yeah, we're talking this morning, weren't we, Derek? When you were 2, what happened?
I started to play Argentina.
Played it when you were little, Derek. Because you had tiny hands.
Yes.
About that big.
That tiny. Big.
And you used to use your thumb a lot, didn't you?
Yeah.
Sometimes you'd use your like chop 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 like that.
Yeah.
Since he was a child, Derek has attracted attention for his unique ability. But although his brain can process music at lightning speed, it took Adam years to teach him the basic fingering skills.
Even today, Derek still doesn't really know his fingers from his thumbs in a way. If you say, you know, which is your left thumb, he'd have difficulty with that. But of course, the minute it touches a keyboard, it's a different matter. He's completely at one. But the only way to show him how to play scales and arpeggios and so on, the sort of stock in trade of any pianist, was physically for him to feel my hands and for me to physically guide him on the keyboard. And I thought it would take a month or two, but it actually took years and years, because in that respect, the learning difficulties were very apparent.
I think nothing gives one the sense of a neural basis for musicality more strongly than these musical savants who suddenly burst into song or play the piano or whatever with almost no training. Although clearly, exposure to music has been important.
Exposure to music, but on the other hand, they're exposed to music, but they can't actually read music. There's no visual aid to it. They just hear it.
They hear it and they get it. And it has a profound effect on them, and they think about it, and music, gets them going to an extraordinary degree.
Yeah. Can you twinkle, twinkle in that style?
I can do twinkle, twinkle in that style. Then.
You watch him playing and, frankly, you marvel at that as you watch his hands and his accomplishment. And then I remember watching him walking here into the rehearsal studio, and I see the kind of pace at which he's moving, the movements of his head, trying to coordinate himself and find his way. And that's clearly... That's kind of a difficult process for him, and yet
there's this sort of immediate transformation. I mean, it's really quite a lot to take in.
I think people, when they see Derek play the piano and hear him, they just can't... It's very hard for them to imagine how difficult a lot of everyday jobs are for Derek. His brain just doesn't wire up to do a lot of the things that we find extremely easy, and yet something that most of us find impossible. He can do it automatically.
You have scanned his brain at some point, didn't you, with an ECG?
Yeah, we did. We did one of those experiments where you put electrodes on the scalp, and we tried playing Derek little fragments of the Moonlight Sonata, some of which had errors in, and we discovered that Derek's brain, in a fraction of a second before you could even consciously be aware of it, had registered what was right and what was wrong. His whole brain was lighting up with the music. And yet the verbal responses he gave were at chance level. It was hit and miss, yes or no. Yet intuitively, his brain was alive with the music.
If you're blind, maybe your brain has space to accommodate something more.
Absolutely. I mean, there's this huge real estate of the visual cortex, and nothing stays empty, and it'll be occupied by auditory stimuli, by tactile stimuli, and so the blind people become, you know, almost supernaturally sensitive in many other ways. They will reach out to sound, to touch, to smell, and those parts of the brain will develop instead. In general, people born blind are disposed to be more musical, and I think blindness must be important with Derek.
Just a final blues or something like
that? A final blues. Basin Street Blues.
Oh, that'd be good, yeah. Wouldn't it?
Basin Street Blues.
Fantastic.
In C.
That makes you happy.
In C. C.
Shall we do it together or do you want to do it as a solo?
Do it together and as a solo.
Oh, all right then, because you always play my parts, don't you, Derek?
I do.
Go on then.
And do it together as well.
All right.
Where are the bits of the brain which relate to our musical sense?
There's no one musical part of the brain, and in fact there's sort of a dozen different parts of the brain which respond to pitch, to rhythm, to timbre, to melodic contour. Although music is all, it's not just all, and it recruits many other parts of the brain. And in fact, you find that visual parts of the brain and motor parts of the brain, and also the parts of the brain concerned with anticipation and expectation. I mean, because one doesn't listen to music passively. One sort of decodes it as one listens, one sees where it's going, one has expectations.
Oliver Sacks has got me thinking, so I've decided to offer myself up as a guinea pig. I'm going to find out what happens to my brain when I listen to music. Neuroscientist Larry Parsons at Sheffield University has designed this especially for me.
You'll be listening to different kinds of music that evoke specific emotional responses.
The team are using a functional MRI scanner, so they'll be able to pinpoint activity in my brain when I listen to the music. To make the test personal to me, I've been asked to select three different types of music. The first is something that makes me happy. Is this a way to Amarillo? A cheery sort of tune. Then something that's annoying, angry music. And finally, a piece that I have a strong emotional connection to, something that moves me. For this, I've chosen my Desert Island Disc, a piece by Strauss, sung by Jesse Norman. It will take a week to process the results. Most of us take music for granted. We simply assume we'll be able to enjoy listening to the music we love. But imagine what life would be like if our brains couldn't decode or make sense of the music we hear. And what's more, what if we didn't understand why that was happening? Even if you don't like classical music, for instance, most of us can appreciate a beautiful piece of Chopin. But what if you're Anne Barker and it just sounds like an ugly noise?
So what about a nice bit of Chopin, then?
No, I would never choose to listen to Chopin while in the car. It's not my idea of fun. That would be really irritating. I think I'd have lots of accidents if I listened to Chopin.
What does the piano do for you, then? What's it? What's the sort of...
I think it's the thumping of the keys that irritate me. It's very... I don't get any pleasure to listen to the piano. It's an irritating sound, particularly classical piano.
Anne has a special condition. Although her hearing is normal, she has the musical equivalent of colour blindness.
You can be deaf to music and to different aspects of music. You can be deaf to pitch. You can be deaf to rhythm. Or even if you hear pitch and rhythm normally, you may be deaf to melody, not just not catch melody, or deaf to harmony. And all of these things are called amusia.
To make matters worse, Anne comes from an extremely musical family. Her parents even own a village shop, which specializes in traditional Irish instruments. Anne is one of eight children. The entire family is the subject of a research study being conducted by Dr. Lauren Stewart. She's trying to find out whether amusia has a genetic or environmental cause.
OK, Anne, I'm going to be playing you pairs of tunes. I want you to tell me if they're exactly the same or slightly different.
Same. Most of these are guessed.
Yeah, don't worry, you're doing fine.
Yeah, you're guessing.
You're doing good.
You're cheating.
No, you're doing your best,
yeah,
aren't you?
Yeah, I don't know if they're the same or different, I have to...
You have to have a go.
I have to have a go.
This is par for the course. Anne manages to guess only 2 out of 10 of the answers this time. And it's only now that she can understand the impact that this disability has had on her throughout her life.
When you, as a kid or a teenager, you went dancing, did you sense that something was wrong?
Oh, I got so many funny stories to tell, but dancing is legendary.
Well, tell me your dancing stories.
My dancing stories. My first experience of dancing was at the age of 5 when my mum sent me to Irish dancing class. And I so much wanted to be a nice Irish dancer. 6 years later, at the age of 11, I was still at the same class, at the beginner's class, with the little children, with the 5-year-olds. And I had practised my steps every night, diligently, for 6 years, and I knew my steps, my jigs and my reels perfectly. And I could not understand why I was still in the same class 6 years later. And looking back as an adult, I think what I was dancing had barely no relationship to the music that was being played, so I can only think that.
So it must have been an immense relief to find out what it was that was wrong.
Incredible, incredible. But as a teenager, none of the boys would dance with me. I used to avoid going anywhere where there was dancing, and still do avoid situations where I have to dance because it's so socially humiliating, absolutely humiliating. I'd love to be able to do salsa. Oh, I'd love that. I want to jive, but no. My prowess was on the football pitch.
Despite it all, Anne still likes the social side of listening to friends and family making music down in the village pub. Her amusia isn't so perplexing now that she's been diagnosed, even if science hasn't yet found a cure for her condition. My scan results are in, and I've come to meet with Professor Larry Parsons to find out how my brain functions when I listen to different types of music. But he's been very cagey about one of my results. It seems something strange was happening in my brain when I listened to the Strauss piece sung by Jesse Norman.
I mean, it's just... Your brain is just bathed in blood.
Bathed in blood, yeah.
It's just blood flow. It's massive.
Yeah, and you've never seen that.
Larry was amazed because my reaction to Jesse Norman's singing was so extreme. My brain seemed to be bathed in blood because I'd had such an intense emotional response. By contrast, the more generic, happy and annoying music samples provoked a more typical reaction.
It's a slightly simplistic idea, isn't it? Are you happy? Are you sad?
Yeah. But just, I mean, just...
Yeah, this is shocking.
Look at this. It's just like night and day.
You better go and do some more work on those. Larry, I need to know.
What else can I do? I just said, look at it, I said, I can't show that. This looks like it's the machine is broken. This is the happy, and this is the angry, and you can see some specific things.
Yeah.
These are your music structure areas that are processing the music. Yeah. And it clearly shows that you were cold in reaction to it.
Yeah.
You had no engagement with it, except a little bit of, you know, maybe annoyance.
And the happy, I had so many potential choices, I didn't quite know how to respond to any of them.
But you had this immense emotional and whole brain reaction to the Jesse Norman, which is just phenomenal. You're just basically swamped in this emotional state. And again, just to refresh you, this is what, you know, the rest of the world's music is like.
There does seem to be some explanation for my extreme results. Apparently, Larry hadn't done an experiment exactly like this before.
Usually you don't look at a single subject's brain. Usually it's combined, after the initial processing, it's combined into group, what we call group averages, of something like 15 people. And then activity like this, unless it were true for all the other people in the group, we wouldn't see it. So I wouldn't normally observe it. But we do know your...
That's a music.
I mean, your whole brain is just like...
It's frozen out.
It's gone into some... Well, it's immersed.
Yeah.
It's a deep immersion of blood flow.
What Larry's experiment seems to tell us is that there's no such thing as an average brain. And there's still so much that scientists don't know about the powerful connections between music and the mind. Perhaps the most mysterious of all of Oliver Sacks' case histories was sparked off by an event which took place in a small town in New York State on a stormy afternoon in August 1994. Tony Chicoria was 42, a former college football player who'd become a well-regarded orthopedic surgeon.
Tony is a surgeon in New York State who had very little musical background or interest or taste or talent, until, through a freak accident, being on the phone in a storm, he was hit in the face by a bolt of lightning, flung back, and killed, in a sense. He probably had a cardiac arrest. He had one of these strange out-of-body experiences, which one can have in these circumstances. Then he was resuscitated. He seemed to be pretty much himself. But then, 3 or 4 weeks after this, a strange transformation happened, where he developed a sudden, insatiable passion, as he put it, for hearing piano music, and then for playing piano music, and then for composing piano music. This took hold of him and wouldn't let him go.
23 College Park Drive. He's playing music.
Practicing. That's just normal for you, is it?
I'm just warming up.
When did this change happen? When did this sort of compulsion
for the music,
happen?
Within that first 2 weeks, I started to have a craving to hear classical piano music, which was unlike me. I was a product of the 60s. I liked loud, hard rock and roll. there wasn't much else. And then within a short period of time, it wasn't enough to just listen to the music. I wanted to be able to play it. And magically, I just ordered all of the sheet music. And it was determined to learn it.
But you couldn't read sheet music?
No. But that's why there was magical thinking. And somehow, it was just going to happen. At the time, I was working full-time as an orthopedic surgeon, 12 to 14 hours, long days. In order to be able to keep up with this possession that I had all of a sudden, I got up at 4 in the morning, and I would practice until 6:30 when I had to go to work. And then I would come back from work, and I would sit there until literally I couldn't see the pages. And unfortunately, the time that I sacrificed was any time that I had with my wife. My obsession with the music certainly was my contributing 50% to our marriage breaking up. For a long time, I thought certainly that the only reason that I was allowed to live was because of the music.
All of this went for him with a sort of mystical or religious feeling.
Because of his near-death experience he had as well.
Or perhaps just because of what was happening with his brain, or perhaps, out of sheer gratitude for surviving this, although I'm inclined to think that there was a definite neurological basis for the mystical surge as well. He said, as a medical man, he said he couldn't explain it. It was due to divine intervention. I wasn't quite sure how to respond to this, but I hope delicately asked him if he would allow that divine intervention might operate via the nervous system.
Nerves, Tony?
Nerves is not even the word.
Tonight's a big night. It's the first performance of the Lightning Sonata, written and performed by Tony Chicoria and inspired by his own extraordinary story.
How many people will be there?
500. There are 500 seats.
I hear it was oversubscribed significantly, is that right?
Yeah. Last I heard were that there were 2,000 requests, and we only have 500 seats, so.
Some point I'm going to have to make a choice between medicine and music.
I'm hoping that I won't have to give up either, that I can find a balance. But I think the music is a much deeper part of me than what I do for a living.
Extraordinary events that led to Tony finding a passion for music have opened up a whole new chapter in his life. And as for Matt, he too has found a way to use the power of music to transform his life. Nearly all the children and young people in Matt's drum workshop also have Tourette's. They've discovered Matt, and he's found his vocation.
I went there one Saturday morning in New York and saw 30 people twitching and ticking violently, out of themselves uncoordinated and all out of synchrony with each other. It was real pandemonium. And yet, when he started the drumming and when others came in, everyone was orchestrated. They formed a group. One saw synchrony, one saw bonding, one saw this primal power of music to not only to synchronize everything in the nervous system, but to synchronize people together.
What of Derek? Challenged since birth by severe autism and blindness, how his brain works is still a mystery. And yet, his extraordinary musical gift, which is entirely instinctive, is quite simply inspirational.
Although I seem to talk about illness and damage and problems, my real theme is survival, how people manage and transcend, you know, often triumphantly. And I think this can happen with many people, that music can somehow bring back the feeling of life when nothing else can.